Good morning. Still have to correct that accent. It's ackee and sawfish. Yeah, we thought it was a fruit and it got recategorized as a vegetable. I still think it's a fruit because it grows on a tree. And the thing is, it's a pod. And if you pick it before the pod bursts on the tree, the poisonous gases remain inside the fruit, and that's what kills you. See, you've got to pick it after the pod is burst. But it's really lovely, and if you ever get to Jamaica, I recommend it. I was apotheosized a little earlier. I was given divine gifts and told that if I said certain things, actions would happen. So I think I should say that you're about to get a printout that I will be explaining in a little while, and I think my apotheosis was not that good because it should have happened immediately as I said it. But I see people coming with the sheets. You know, I've heard the name Reverend Amy DeLong for a long time. And it's been my pleasure to meet you by listening to you and my challenge to follow you. That's perhaps one reason why I wish I were still in the seats. A second reason I wish is that passage, that paraphrase of that passage. You know, those religious scholars sound really bad. It suddenly feels like high-risk time. And while those sheets are being passed out, you know, I planned to start in the very way I didn't, which was to call you all co-creators, beloved people of God, beloved kin, co-sojourners and co-seekers, co-prophets and co-visionaries. And to think of myself as part of the family of God gathered here this morning. But I have a confession to make that I really feel strange this morning. I think it's my accent that reminds me that I have come here from outside, from beyond. And I know there's one other Jamaican in the room. Is there anybody else from the Caribbean? See, I also represent one of those groups that gets to your general conference, I think it is, and votes against your interests. And here I am, wishing to speak with you, but a co-sojourner and a co-seeker with you nonetheless. Many, many years ago, when I had just left seminary, I had the fortune stroke misfortune to be chosen by the Methodist Church in the Caribbean and the Americas, into which I had been recently ordained, to represent the Caribbean at the August Oxford Institute for Methodist Theological Studies meeting in Oxford. You know, a theology degree in the Caribbean is an undergraduate degree, and you've got to understand that I was just about 28 years old at the time and very recently ordained, and found myself in the midst of all these doctors. And I just had a BA in theology, and these were huge doctors. But it planted a vision in my mind of the possibilities of the Caribbean and what we could do if some of us got to this place where those doctors were. Little did I know then that that moment of inspiration would have carried me to this place, where while my accent makes me feel strange, the fact of being among the people of God makes me feel hopeful. The fact that I stand among you in a way I did not envisage then, as a Jamaican ordained pastor who has transferred her ministry, her ordination to the United Methodist Church, and to stand in front of you as a gay Jamaican pastor. with a partner who would have loved to have been here, but couldn't be. But here we are, co-seekers and co-sojourners. It's a beautiful, beautiful thought. I want you to travel with me. You have those handouts? I want you to travel with me in these 3 days, because I am not going to do a comfortable thing, and I'm not going to do the accustomed thing. I'm not even going to carefully read and exegete and expound biblical texts for you. I'm inviting you on a different kind of journey in relation to the Bible. And that leaflet that you just got is meant to orient you to the study and give you an idea of the passages that we will reference. I thought you might like to have something to scan for the study before you recycle the paper for some purpose like spills, padding, or some other pre-discard use. This is a journey that we are undertaking together. The study will be a bit unusual. It might even strike you as odd. I hope it doesn't strike you as irrelevant. Actually, the study will be itself a new song. Perhaps I should be less ambitious and designate it as a song in a different key. And I'm supposed to give another kind of instruction and say, first slide. First slide? Thank you. A song, perhaps in a different key, if not altogether a new song. I hope that the journey will take us from opening bars to a satisfactory tail-wagging coda of the type that makes you want to sing again. I invite you to travel this road with me as we think along together. So let us begin. I can't pronounce that. It's an awkward construction meant to indicate the convergence of signing and singing. That we who sing are also the signs of the new song. And we are signing, singing a new way. And part of that new way is for us to name ourselves. I liked what Reverend DeLong just did in getting us all to affirm the love of God without a but. Because that too is what I want us to do. And then to live into it in relation to the Bible. And I'll say a little bit more about that. But first I want us to name who we are and name those who have gone before us, whether passed on or still alive. So our act of prayer this morning is also an act of singing the new song that we sang. But we're going to ground ourselves in the past for a moment. I know Isaiah said last night that we should not remember the past. But as a two-thirds world person, it's hard sometimes to forget, and I have to figure out which parts of the past I should remember and which parts I can't afford to forget, which leaves me in the place where I have to remember anyway. But I want you in this moment to pause and where you are, name people, whether they have gone ahead or are still here but are the heroes of our lived past. The people who have helped to bring you to the place where you are today. Just shout out the name. Julia Davis and Bishop Leontine Kelly. These are our cloud of witnesses. They are our tradition. I want you to hold that. They are our tradition. They are the people, and I learned this in a United Methodist Clergy Women's consultation from my African American clergy sisters when they talked about standing on the shoulders of those who have gone before. The people you named are the people whose shoulders you stand upon as we reach now for this new song. So ashe and amen. Last night I listened to the bishop's letter, and we're going to get to the Bible, so movingly read. I got the message. I just want you to really get the foundation to travel with me. I got the message that it is difficult to sing a song, a new song, in the midst of alienation. It's difficult to sing when you are oppressed. But how appropriate that message was as it landed in a liturgy that included a psalm of lament that engages a question of singing where one does not belong. These exiles who sang Psalm 137 bequeathed a memory that suggests that the ability to sing is linked to place and belonging. Little wonder, is it, that different lands produce different rhythms, as does different historical experiences produce different songs. Those exiles were not the first, and assuredly they were not the last, to sing a new song in a strange place, to ask the question. And I bring my Jamaican-ness to you. Please receive it. I turned to a group of Jamaicans who sang that Jewish song in the rhythms of our undulating mountains, gentle seas, and soothing trade winds. This group that sings represent a subcultural people like ourselves gathered here, living in a land of strangeness, with odd buffoonery parading the streets and occupying rostrums with pretensions to wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. We need to know how to sing our songs in a strange land. So I bring my Jamaican melodians to you, singing by the rivers of Babylon. Listen to them. I think it will come up as apotheosis has to work. This is Bible. And if you feel like dancing, you can get up and do it. I would sing, but I don't. How can we sing King Alpha's song? The wicked carried us away captivity. Required from us a song. How can we sing King Alpha's song in a strange land? Sing it aloud. Sing a song of freedom. Sing a song of freedom, brother. Okay, thank you. Thank you. That song comes from the depth of Jamaica's social ladder. Did you hear the beat? Did you feel the strength and the energy in it? Well, I really wanted you to feel that strength and energy, because that is a strength and energy I want you to carry into this singing a new song, reading the Bible. Singing a new song, reading the Bible. So you can't read the Bible the same way you always have. There's a fellow by the name of Dale Martin who wrote a book called Sex and the Single Apostle. And here's what Dale Martin said, and I like to demonstrate what he says in one of the chapters of his book. He says, the Bible says nothing. That's the first thing he says. The Bible says nothing. So he says, put the Bible down and wait for it to speak. I've waited longer, and I promise you it doesn't. The point he's making is that the Bible only says what we say it says. Okay? And that's why we have to know who we are and what our traditions are when we begin to say what the Bible says. And we've got to ensure that we're speaking from our traditions and not from somebody else's traditions. More to come. So now I'm going to ask you to turn to someone, one-on-one or one-on-two, as needs be, and just say something that you're comfortable with about yourself. Just say something to someone. Identify yourself in some way. Anything. I love sweets. I'm an idiot when I'm at home. I'm gay. I would like to be gay. I want to hear you talking. Make sure everybody gets a turn. Okay, do you know who you are? Do you know who you are over here? Yeah? Over here? You know who you are? You've identified yourself and you have identified yourself. Good. So you've done two things. Oh, they're loving chatting to each other. You've done two things en route to singing a new song, reading the Bible. You have named your predecessors and ancestors, and you have named who you are, located yourself, and defined yourself. The benefit of doing that is that you can claim your own questions. You can claim your own questions. You do not have to answer anybody else's questions. You can claim your own questions. Question, and that's important to singing a new song. I'm going to expose my questions to you as a model that I offer to you. I'm not suggesting to you that these questions I raise are the questions that you need to ask. I'd love it if you asked them, but you don't have to ask them. I am just modeling a way for you. The questions I have, and then I'm going to give you some background. Listen to them. Are there thought trajectories within biblical traditions that progressive thinkers can identify with? Are there thought trajectories in the Bible, within biblical traditions, that progressive thinkers can identify with? I haven't asked about biblical passages. Just trajectories, lines of thinking in the Bible. Second question, if they are there, how do we discern them? Third question, how can progressive thinkers relate to these trajectories should we be persuaded that they are there? My task is to try and persuade you that they are there, these thought trajectories. Which is why it's important that you look at that little leaflet that you got at some point, because on that leaflet, there are biblical passages that I'm going to be looking at. I've added some since I wrote it up, and a little bit of a blurb explaining to you some of the thought processes that are going into this biblical study. But you can look at them while I speak and later on. The questions are not on that blurb, and I will repeat the questions later. But here's the background. I just store up this because I'm not too good with that. Here's what's happening. You know, I'm using gay and lesbian, LGBTQIQ people to think with as we discuss these progressive trajectories. Have you ever tried to respond to the biblical criticisms about being gay? I mean, Leviticus, you know, an abomination to the Lord. Oh my gosh. Here's a conversation. Conservative friend says, you know the Bible says you're an abomination. Oh no, it doesn't really say I'm an abomination. You really have to have the history behind it. What is the history again? You really have to have the history behind it and know technically what the etymology of the word abomination is in Hebrew before you can actually say what the text means. Who is listening still? And we could go on and on. Arsena coitus. Oh my gosh, we still haven't even figured out properly what that word means. It has so many possibilities. And the possibility that you pick is dependent on where you want your ideology to go. If you're progressive, you know, it's not really going to mean homosexuals. It's just a translation prejudice that seeped in because the early translators didn't really understand homosexuality. You know, and if you want it to be against homosexuals, then you jolly well say it is a word that means homosexuals. Who arbitrates in that process? And where are we left? There's something else that Dale Martin said, and I want us to hear it very carefully. He said, when it comes on to progressives and conservatives, and I don't like the labels, but they're very convenient for buzzwords. When it comes down to conservatives and liberals, we read the Bible the same way. Some of us are saying historical criticism, some of us aren't. But we all read the Bible the same way. Next slide. We are foundationalists, he says. The Bible, whether we are conservative or progressive or liberal, the Bible is a foundational document that normativizes our lives and turns norms into normalcy. It justifies, as I think I heard Bishop Yvette Flunder saying yesterday, we can use it to justify the things we want to have justified, and that is true whether you're liberal or conservative. You're going to use it to justify what you want it to justify and legitimize what you want legitimized. And so we go through a process of selection. Which verses are we going to like and which verses are we not going to like? And we don't like the ones that don't like us, and we like the ones that like us. You know, let's be honest about that and recognize it as a legitimate reading strategy. But that's what we do. Whether we're conservative or progressive, the Bible is foundational for us. And here's where we end up. I think I have one more slide. Here is where we end up. Us progressives, in a hierarchical relationship with the Bible is over our heads, an ossified document of stage stagnant words that we're trying desperately to yield life out of. The book. Bibliolatry. And it's our hierarchy, because it's there above us. We're looking up at it while all of our modern lives get trashed for meaningfulness too often. It's a kind of graphic and extreme image, but it wants to say something about the way in which we as progressives relate in exactly the same way to the Bible at a certain level as the conservatives do. We all wanted to say we are right. So I'm looking for another way. I'm looking for another way for us to read the Bible. Hence the questions. I want to get away from the hierarchy. Hence the questions. Hence your tradition. Hence your identity and location, your culture, who you are, the wisdom you have discerned in this day and age throughout your life. Some of you have more gray hair than I do. You've lived long. You've learned much. You've seen much. And some people in this room haven't gotten their gray hairs yet. They have a ways to go. And they have already seen things that many of us with gray hairs have not yet seen or didn't see when we were their age. Yet all of us have this belief, this conviction, that culture 2,000 years ago produced the last word on God. produced the last word on the richness and fullness of life. If Jesus was crucified and raised again, our attitude to the Bible suggests that God became silent, died, and never rose again. Because the book is stiff for us. You might think, does she even like the Bible? Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I love the Bible, and that's why I want to ask the question, does the Bible have any progressive thought trajectories in it? Not what the texts say, but is the Bible at any point progressive? Can it be our book in a way that it is not the conservatives' book? That's my agenda. Can it be our book in a way that is not the conservatives? Because, you know, the conservatives have picked up those passages. And remember, I'm thinking with gay folk. The conservatives have picked up those passages that they say talk about gay. And we are spinning our wheels trying to persuade them that it doesn't really say anything bad about gay. And we go home and we are, this is a Jamaican thing, you know, feeling whipped. Because we just can't get the succinct statement out that will persuade anyone. I want us to look in on ourselves just for these three sessions. Just look in on ourselves, not look out at them. Look in at ourselves and claim that identity that we have. And ask, is there anything in the Bible, not textually, but any way the Bible relates to itself intratextually that looks like us? And I'm going to be self-serving here, let me be honest, and say, you know, character descriptions of progressives. We like to talk. We're conversationalists. We're dialogical people. We will talk. And we will talk for transformation. And transformation involves the acknowledgement of diversity. So I came up with three nice words. Conversation, transformation, and diversity. I could have gone with diversification, but I stuck with diversity. Does the Bible do any of that in its internal relationships? You have to imagine something different. You know, remember, we're singing a new song, new key, new words, you know, a little different. So you've got to imagine the book, not as something bound and pasted together with very thin leaves that you have to turn carefully. You've got to imagine this book now as representing a culture. Even if it's an old one, but not a culture that has the last word on God, but representing a culture. So here's where I go, and I have to thank Reverend Dr. Cheryl Anderson for this, as I go to Genesis chapter 1 and 2. Very beginning. Genesis 1 and 2, the two creation stories that we know best. I have listened to people harmonize these two stories that had no intention of being harmonized. I have listened to these stories being set up as examples of how the Bible contradicts itself, and oh, that is so bad of the Bible. And the Bible has no problem contradicting itself. It is perfectly okay with contradictions, but us Westerners who want to have life harmonized and homogenized and filled with certitudes, wants the Bible to have certainty. And we call it a book of life when none of us has a life of certainty. We are the contradiction that we fear. And the Bible is saying, we argue just like progressives. I can just imagine, I mean, this is my imagination, you know, that the book, Genesis 1 and 2, those two chapters, you know, thank you, Cheryl. Chapter 1 is a priestly document. And chapter 2 is a Yahwistic document, P and J. So here's how it goes. But the J's are older than the P's. But the P's took over and got chapter 1, and the J's got left with chapter 2 and 3. Sounds like us and the conservatives, doesn't it? So here's how I imagine it happening. They're in council. And the P's are saying, well, you know, life has to be regulated. And the best regulation comes from an authoritative voice and an autocratic God. So we believe that when God speaks, and you notice I deepened my voice, I am so gender influenced. When God creates, God speaks. And it happens. That's what we think. And the J people are over there saying, you gotta be kidding me. That's not how it happens. God is a dirty guy. You know, God gets down there, and girl, God gets down there and gets her hands dirty in the dirt and forms. No far distant speaking, and it happens. No. Look at those fingernails. God needs a pedicure, a manicure. Because the God of Genesis 2 is a down dirty creature. The God of Genesis 1 is a distant person. I almost said fellow, but I knew the men would get me for that one. You know, gendering distance. They could have said, well, only one can get in the book. But they said, nah, both virgins are going to be there. Both versions are going to be there. Now, I don't think they would have claimed themselves to be progressive, but I feel like they look like me. They look like me, like someone who wants to have the conversation in evidence. Someone who wants to have the conversation happening and to hold both sides, all three sides, all four sides, all five sides of the conversation and keep it in the same book so that generations to come will know we didn't agree, but we agreed to disagree in the same place. And that's progressive. That's progressive. You see what I'm saying? I'm not saying you have to agree with their Genesis story. You know, that's another conversation. I'm just saying, see that they agreed to disagree and stay in the same place. That's a progressive instinct. There's lots of things that are traditionalist about the Bible. But there are these moments when its capacity to transform, to stay in place despite disagreement, comes into view. And that's what I'm looking for in this question today. I should put on my glasses so I can actually see what I wrote. That is tremendously helpful. But it's also thematic. And I'm skating on very thin ice here. And I want you to know I'm skating on thin ice. The thin ice is that I'm going to contrast Exodus chapter 20 and John 3:16. I don't want you to think that the God of Exodus 20 fully describes the diversity of opinions that ancient Jews had on God. We do that very often. You know, the God of the Old Testament is a God of judgment. Yeah? But the Christian God is a God of grace. Nah. That's not how it is. That's our short form for Judaism, but it's not true. But I'm going to do something that resembles that, so I want you to know that I don't believe what I just said. I mean, about... Well, you'll get it. You know, the God in Exodus 20 is a jealous God. A possessive, hissy fit kind of a God. You shall have no other gods before me. And some people love that you shall have no other gods before me kind of business, because it means that you can have other gods, but just don't make them be before me. Gotta get your priorities right here. And I, God, am your Lord. And that uncomfortable covenant relationship, yeah, it's a two-sided covenant relationship where God agrees to do something for these people if they follow him. But that God really wants you to follow him. Lock, step, pee, pee, cluck, cluck. mother hen and chickens. And that God will hold you. Then we preach our evangelistic crusades, John 3:16. God so loved the world that God gave God's only begotten Son. And I could stop at after God so loved the world and not go on to that God gave God's only Son. Because then I can say that the Christian God is a God of love, where that Exodus God is just one jealous being. And I can be happy that the Christian God is better than the Jewish God. But it's interesting that just prior to John 3:16 and John 3:11-15, Jesus is likened and actually supersedes Moses. But the passage cannot escape its Jewish tradition. It has to return to its Jewish tradition to reference and contrast who Jesus is. So that when you get to God so loved the world, I'm going to invite you to imagine that God so loved the world was not a concept that was born when Jesus was crucified on the cross. That it was a concept that the Jews had been meditating upon for millennia, thinking about in a variety of ways. And that love permeates the Hebrew scriptures. Otherwise, Abraham would be in a sorry state. That fellow was pathetic. You remember what he did to his wife? How many times he sold her off to some other man? So that he, I'm going to quote him it along, so that he could protect his posterior? Sorry fellow. Lot was not the only sorry one in that story. Abraham had his problems. God loved Abraham. David, the man after God's own heart. What a stud. By our standards, he should be out of the picture. God loved. When the Johannine community wrote this, I am suggesting to you that they were transforming their tradition. They were not leaving it. They were transforming their tradition. And I have this image working in my mind that tradition is important. But it's not the last word. Tradition can be like an anchor. You know, when a ship is in a storm, you want to put the anchor down and hold your place so that the ship just doesn't get sent off course, crashing upon rocks or whatever. The anchor holds, but there comes a time when the storm is over when you've got to weigh that anchor and put it on the deck of the ship and move on. Tradition has to be acknowledged and recognized perhaps, but you cannot live to conserve it. It has to be transformed. And I'm going to suggest to you that the role of the progressive movement in relation to conservatism is to give conservatism a vessel to travel in, not for conservatives to be playing one-upmanship with us and our traditions and winning the day. We have to think through ways of reading this text when we have done here that allows us to not use the same text that the conservatives use to talk about LGBTQ people. And I really want you to get that. We've got to stop using their texts and ask our own questions. And you've got to stay with me to session 3, because that's when I'll tell you some of the texts we can use. I'll share with you some of the texts we can use. See, I watch serials on television too. I learn. Two things so far. The Genesis 1 and 2 as records of an ancient debate, not just ossified tales on a page, but records of an ancient debate in which we can see that debate and disagreement not only are good, but will happen, and not be afraid of it. The second thing is to transform our traditions and not be afraid, because there's a lot of that stuff in the biblical texts. Transforming the traditions. I'm going to just pause a moment and give you a chance to catch your breath and think about that. Time? I come from Jamaica. What do you mean time? Okay, just catch your breath for a moment. And it is time. So I'm just going to barely reference the last passage. I'm going to point you to Matthew chapter 13. I'm going to suggest when you read it, don't ask the question, what is the kingdom of heaven like? I mean, you can ask that sometimes. What is the kingdom of heaven like? That's sort of what that is about. But I want you to notice the diversity in the passage. You know, just look at the number of different images that Jesus uses to describe the kingdom of heaven. A sower, a merchant, someone who has lost a treasure, the woman who has lost a coin. So many different images packed into that one place. And here we are living in a world where people are dying to say, willing to say, cruelly ready to say, that only one kind of person can represent the kingdom of heaven. I'm thinking with the scriptures. How dare anyone say that heterosexuality is it? How dare anyone say that a certain kind of gender normativity is it? When Jesus himself was tested, and the community that held his memory was tested to find a multiplicity of images to talk about the kingdom of heaven. And here we are narrowing it down to manageable dimensions and distorting it. And we are contorting ourselves in an effort to prove that we belong. When you claim your tradition, you begin to sing in a new song, you begin to sing in a new key, you begin to use your own words and ask your own questions. And that's when what Reverend DeLong did this morning begins to make deep cellular sense inside of us. We're not just mouthing it, but that we are going to believe as progressives. We are going to believe as LGBTQQI people that when we say we are God's children, it means something when we read the Bible. We are going to read that book with our eyes and with our questions, and God bless anybody who doesn't like it, because God is blessing us who like it. And that's the final word for this morning. So you got to come tomorrow. Catch you next.
Thank you, Dr. Spencer Miller.
Wow, I'm coming back tomorrow. How about you? Yeah. And Sunday, or Saturday, the last day, sorry. Okay, so now it's time for us to get up and move and go to your workshops. So we're going to continue to feed ourselves intellectually and spiritually as well. So look on page 23 of your workbooks if you don't remember which workshop you're going to or where you're going.
And lunch is at 12 noon for those who purchase the meal plan, and plenary is at 1:30 here with Bishop.